And now, Daljit Dhaliwal.
In her recent trip to China, Secretary of State Hillary Rodham Clinton underscored the importance of U.S.-China cooperation on climate change. For insight on Clinton's trip and the environmental movement in China, we're joined by Yingling Liu, the China Program Manager at the Worldwatch Institute in Washington, D.C. Yingling, welcome back to the program. Good to see you again.
Good to see you too.
So let's first of all go over what are the key concerns for China's environmentalists.
The major pressing environmental concerns right now in China is air pollution, water pollution, and waste problem, including urban solid waste and industrial waste. And people there are worried about whether they will get cancer or other deadly diseases from pollution, or they are worried about whether their unborn babies get affected by pollution. So the concerns that Chinese people are facing are very different from the concerns by the people in developed countries. I think that this is determined by the development stage a country is in. China currently is in the heavy industrialization stage, a stage that developed countries have experienced and completed long before. And the developed countries were able to develop, pollute, and clean up over centuries. But China does not have the time or capacity to wait.
And Chinese citizens and Chinese environmental groups have become a lot more vocal in their criticism of the government and of the way that pollution is affecting their communities. Do they have freedom to criticize the government? I mean, these are environmental NGOs?
Most of the environmental NGOs tend to work with the government, because if you talk about the state, like criticize the state, you have to differentiate the central government and local government. The environmental branch of the central government have been making very good environmental policies, but their branches who are responsible for the implementation of those policies are dependent on local governments for resources and administrative power. So in this way, they lack the independence to they lack the teeth in implementation, and local governments have their own agenda. Like they may stress economic growth over environmental protection. They care more about the employment, fiscal income than environmental protection. So most of the environmental groups are working with the central government in working as watchdog over the policy implementations at the local level, and also as a check against powerful local governments. Governments and powerful industries in environmental offenses.
So how does anything get done at the end of the day? Because one of the criticisms, as I'm sure you're quite aware, is that the Chinese government has done a tremendous amount of work in terms of churning out the legislation. But when it comes to implementation, it falls far short. I mean, can you share any examples with us of where major polluters who have violated the law have had their factories or companies shut down?
I think you cut right to the core of the problem. Actually, this is right the reason why the environmental movement started up in China. And the environmental movement came into formal being with the help of the central government. And many people do not know this fact, but it is true. In 1993, the environmental branch of the top legislature organized a nationwide media campaign and to publicize and raise public awareness of environmental policies and regulations. Groups of journalists are dispatched nationwide to do investigations, and their findings are published throughout the media. And this is the first time that environmental problems were brought to the wide public attention. So 1 year later, the top legislature passed a law granting formal legal status to social organizations. So right after the enact of this law, the first independent environmental group got registered in Beijing. And the environmental movement in China has been facilitated by a series of milestone laws and regulations made by the central government, including an environmental impact assessment law to encourage broader public participation, and also a guidance on the full implementation of the law on state secrets to force government agencies to disclose unclassified information for public review.
And what is the trade-off here for the government and for these NGOs who, as you're saying, are completely, they're not independent at all?
I should say that the green NGOs in China are not enjoying the independence in the Western sense, but they do have a kind of a support from the government. The biggest challenge lies in the government attitudes. They are very dubious, the dubious attitudes towards those social groups. On one hand, the government need extra help from those groups for environmental protection, for addressing environmental problems in the country. On the other hand, the government is very suspicious of their practices and also wary of their power. So the government is taking very cautious and calculating steps in empowering this sector, while at the same time keeping them under tight control. So many of the environmental groups have to operate in those safe areas, like cooperate with the government, align their practices with the central government environmental priorities. And also in that way, they can maximize the effectiveness of their practices. Mm. So they benefit from that.
Well, there has been a lot of talk about helping China switch from fossil fuels, burning coal, which is a dirty fuel and is responsible for the emissions of carbon dioxide into the air. What kinds of alternatives are there in China to burning fuel? Is there wind and solar and nuclear power that China has been able to harness? Does it have those kind of technologies in terms of also cleaning its coal?
The renewable energy industry has been taking off in China, and particularly the solar PV industry and also the wind industry, they see like double-digit increase annually for the past several years. Although the current share of renewable energy in China's energy mix is still pretty small, roughly 8%, including big hydro. But the government is trying to increase the share to 15% by 2020, given the scale of the economy and the total amount of consumption. That means this is a really significant, ambitious plan.
All right, Yingling Liu, good to see you again. Thank you very much for coming back on the program.
Thank you, too. Mm-hmm.